Christopher Columbus, a man of great controversy these days, whose day of recognition has since passed, but no doubt his legacy still tarnished by those who accuse him of genocide and of mistreatment of the indigenous Americans, those who want nothing more than to scrub his name out of every history book and to burn his effigy in the public square. So who was Christopher Columbus? Was he a saint? Villain? Some nuanced character we hear so much about these days? All that and more will be addressed in today's video. People who often criticize Christopher Columbus, they rarely tend to know who Nicolas de Ovando is, or Francisco de Bobadilla, or Francisco Roldan. I hope I said those names correctly, according to the proper pronunciation. Regardless, there are so many more people to which we could take umbrage with. People who indeed committed abuses against the indigenous people. But it is always Columbus that they look to. And to understand who Columbus is, and also why I think people hate him so much, it is important to look at his motivations. What made Christopher Columbus tick? Why did he do the things he did? People often know that he set sail going east, or rather west, in order to find a shorter trade route to the east. He wanted to find a shorter trade route in order to, of course, make money, but people don't know why he wanted to make money. People just maybe perhaps assume that he was greedy or had a lust for gold, but this is not the case at all. And to begin, Christopher Columbus was born in 1451 in Genoa, Italy. 2 years later, there would be an incredible event, a very unfortunate event in the history of Europe, which is the sacking of Constantinople. Constantinople was the second probably most holy city in all of Christendom, the first being of course Rome, and so the idea that Constantinople would fall to the hands of the Ottomans, who were Muslim, was this great scar. It was a great scar on Christianity, and it was a sign, according to Christopher Columbus, that the end times were near, and he believed that the Great Tribulation was going to be soon, and then the millennial reign of Jesus Christ. In order for this to happen, two things were necessary, because Christopher Columbus read his Bible, and he was a very devout Catholic. He knew that there were two things that were necessary in order for Jesus to return. The first was that the temple in Jerusalem must be restored, and the second was that all people, regardless of where they lived, would have to hear the name of Jesus Christ. All peoples would have to be exposed to the truth of the gospel and the truth of the Holy Catholic Church. And so those were at the forefront of Christopher Columbus' minds, to convert people and to at least teach them about Jesus Christ and to restore Jerusalem and to restore Israel to Christian hands. And in order to do that, that would require another crusade. Crusades obviously cost a lot of money, and for that reason, Christopher Columbus wanted to make money through these shorter trade routes that he believed that he could establish in order to finance a new crusade, so we could bring in the millennial reign of Jesus Christ. His motivations at the core were religious. He was a devoutly religious man, and it's probably for that reason that the enemies of Jesus Christ hate him so severely. I don't think it is a coincidence that none of the enemies of Jesus Christ ever talk about Nicolas de Ovando, who committed much more grave atrocities against the indigenous people than Columbus ever did. In fact, Columbus was put up for canonization for sainthood after the First Vatican Council. And once I explain his life, you'll understand why. To begin, Christopher Columbus, when he set sail on the Santa Maria. He named his ship after Mary because he believed that Mary was watching over him. In fact, Christopher Columbus prayed 8 times a day. He prayed the breviary. And before Vatican II, it was 8 prayers. It was sext, non, compline, vespers, etc. And the only priests or religious monks would pray these prayers, but Christopher Columbus, he had grown up praying them, and he continued to pray them even on his voyage. In fact, before his voyage even set off, They held mass in order to dedicate their travels to Jesus Christ. So at the forefront, always at the forefront of Christopher Columbus's mind is God, is the reign of Christ. On the ship, at every hour, they had an hourglass that would turn. And when they were turning the hourglass, because obviously it's before the age of pocket watches or clocks, they would call out some religious event, the birth of Jesus, or the resurrection, or the Immaculate Conception. They would just call this out. And at the end of the day, at Vespers, the crew would get together and sing various prayers like the Our Father and the Angelus. And what a beautiful sight that must have been. Just to hear in the silence of the water at night, the sound of these burly, strong Mediterranean men singing in unison the Angelus. That would be quite the spectacle to observe. So we can see that Christopher Columbus was very religious. He was inspired by his faith in Jesus Christ. In fact, this is demonstrating heroic virtue here. Oftentimes, I think people see him as perhaps this kind of this ambiguous character, or very nuanced, he uses ups and downs, when in fact, I am going to make the argument that he was a man of heroic virtue, and he is someone that should be celebrated. And if you look at his the disposition he has when he first arrives in the Indies, he believes that he has found, he knows he found some island that is not Japan. He was aiming first for Japan in order to meet with the Great Khan in order to establish some new trade routes. He understands he's in some islands. The first impulse he has is one of hospitality. And let me read for you a quote here in his diary and page 65. I, in order that they would be friendly to us, recognized that they were a people who would be better freed from error and converted to our holy faith by love than by force. To some of them I gave red caps and glass beads, which they put in their chests, and many other small things of value, which they took so much pleasure and became so much our friend that it was a marvel. Christopher Columbus was very interested in being friends with the natives because he wanted to convert them. He wanted to convert them to Christianity, as all Catholics should desire. As all Catholics should desire, the conversion of all people to Jesus Christ. And so I believe that it is probably divine providence that Christopher Columbus was the man who was able to open up the old world to the new world. He was the man who would bring Christianity and bring Catholicism to these barbaric people. Obviously, there was varying degrees of barbarianism, as we'll talk about, but they were not Christian. In fact, Columbus was very impressed by the intelligence, the ingenuity. He was very impressed by the canoes and the houses that these people had built. He even took the hammock, which was something that the indigenous people had invented, and he used it on his own ships. And so Christopher Columbus was not racist. He did not look down on these people, but in fact, had a lot of respect for them. When the his men on board and the settlers had been rummaging around certain villages, they found these heads. And they found heads of men that were on like a platter or something like that, on like the wall. And it looked like they were being venerated. Perhaps it was some pagan ritual. And Christopher Columbus, he gave them the benefit of the doubt and said that he thought it was some way of bearing and to honor. It was some way to give honor to someone's ancestors was by displaying their head or something like that. Christopher Columbus was the one who gave them the benefit of the doubt. I have some more quotes here in which he talks again about trying to convert the Indians. He says, quote, I do not detect in any of them any religion, and I believe that they would become good Christians very quickly because they are of a very good understanding. And that's from page 89. And he says also that, quote, I did not allow anything to be taken, not even the value of a pin. From page 107, by anything taken, he means taken from the Indians. Now you see, when the settlers arrived, oftentimes the Indians would run away because they were scared. You know, these people with beards and giant ships, and you know, it's a very new sight to these indigenous people. And then when they ran away, it was a great temptation for these settlers to loot the villages. Of course, the settlers and the people on Columbus's ship had not eaten good food and water for quite some time, so there's a real temptation there. But Columbus was the one who put a restraint and said, no, you can't loot, You can't take anything, not even a pin. And it should also be reminded, and we should also be reminded that slavery is not a European institution. One of the great faux pas of the left or the cancel culture is, of course, the European slavery. They say that this is a blight on our record. And what it should be constantly reminded is that this is not something that Europeans invented. What is unique to Europeans is the fact that we ended slavery for humanitarian and religious reasons. You can read the writings of William Wilberforce in England. You can look at the popes who abolished slavery in the Catholic countries in Spain. You can look to these things to see that it was the Europeans who were interested in ending slavery for very humanitarian and religious reasons, whereas in other places, perhaps because of economic reasons, or perhaps because the UN told them they need to end slavery, or some other external, extrinsic factor. I mean, this is not an exception with the indigenous people prior to Columbus. They had been enslaving each other for quite some time. In fact, there is even cannibals that were enslaving and sodomizing other tribes. So this is pretty bad. It just makes sense now why Columbus had to come, why God permitted Columbus to come and bring Christianity to this very godless people. And it's not just Christopher Columbus who believed this. It was the sovereigns in Spain. It was King Ferdinand and Queen Isabella. They also wanted to see that the natives were treated well and properly so that they would be converted. Christopher Columbus believed, quote, to be very ripe to be converted to our holy Catholic faith, since they have neither dogma or doctrine. They being, of course, the native Indians. The Indians were very ripe to be converted, and for that reason, this is the proclamation that was given to the crew members aboard Christopher Columbus's ship, once they, of course, discovered that there were these people living here in the Indies. They said, quote, to treat the said Indians very well and lovingly, and abstain from doing them any injury, arranging that both peoples hold much conversation and intimacy, each serving the others to the best of their ability. And if any person should maltreat the said Indians in any manner whatsoever, let me read that again. If any person should maltreat the said Indians in any manner whatsoever, the said admiral, as viceroy and governor of their highness, shall punish them severely by virtue of the authority vested in him by their majesties for this purpose. The viceroy, admiral, and governor was Christopher Columbus. In other words, the king and queen of Spain are saying, don't mistreat the Indians, and if you do, Christopher Columbus is going to discipline you. This is what the Catholic Christopher Columbus and the Catholic monarchs in Spain desired. It is completely in line with everything that is good and right. And the fact that they have been so maligned by the current culture, by the current cancel culture, they've been so maligned by everything going on right now in the media is absolutely disgusting. No one ever talks about this. No one ever talks about the initiatives to hold back and restrain the bad people who would want to take advantage of the Indians. In fact, the people who were enslaved, there were some, these were what are called the Caribs. And the Caribs were these people who were cannibals. They were cannibals, and they were also known to commit sodomy. And for this reason, they were taken as slaves, because according to papal policy, there are three reasons in which you could take a slave. Either it was a just war, they resisted Christianization, or three, they committed acts contrary to the natural order. And the Caribs fit all three of this. They were committing acts against the natural order through cannibalism and sodomy. They resisted Christians and even fought against Christians in a war. And while slavery, according to Thomas Aquinas, is not the natural state of man, because of our fallen state, because of their sin nature, slavery has been used at times as a form of punishment. Obviously, now I'm not saying that it would be applicable, but at one time it was applicable, and it was seen as something that was valid and just, and Pope Pius II, who Christopher Columbus was no doubt a fan of, said that the natives who converted to Christianity could never be enslaved, but those who resisted Christianity could be enslaved, and of course, according to papal policy, if they committed a just war or something like that, slavery was an inevitable consequence. And this is just standard policy at the time that all of the Christian West knew and observed. Christopher Columbus was not in any more way less or more evil because he went with the established policies of the Pope. Furthermore, Pope Pius II said, quote, "Salvation escapes from the ills and evils of this world and eternal life, where what Christians sought not social and political reform in this world." In other words, at the point of allowing slaves to be captured who were not Christians was that they might become Christians. That was the goal. The goal was that these cannibals who were not Christians would be hopefully converted to Christianity, and obviously be due to their upbringing as cannibals in this very perverse environment, it's not going to be easy to convert them. And so that is why it makes sense to use a little bit more force and aggression. In fact, Christopher Columbus sent them explicitly to Spain, the cannibals that he enslaved, in order so that they would be converted. Christopher Columbus gave explicit instruction that they be educated and to be taught to read so that they could, in fact, convert to Christianity.
He says here, quote, "Would not be anything but well for that they be one day led to abandon that inhuman custom which they have of eating men. If they learned the language, they'd become good interpreters, and if they learned about the Christian faith, they would much more readily receive baptism and secure the welfare of their souls."
And indeed, Christopher Columbus goes on to say, "Great credit will be gained by us, for they will serve as an example to all the people of this great island, who, when they see the good treatment which is meted out to well-doers and the punishment which is inflicted upon those who do evil," in other words, the cannibals, who are cannibalizing the other people in the Indies. Not the Christians, by the way. It was the other people in Hispaniola who are being cannibalized and sodomized. It will quickly come to obedience so that it will be possible to command them as vassals. In other words, Christopher Columbus did not desire for the natives to be slaves. He made a very clear distinction here between the vassals and slaves. Slaves were those people who refused Christianization and were warring against the Christians, and slavery was just a natural punishment that would hopefully convert them to Christianity. The other Indians were vassals. And I know at today that's a dirty word in this very Marxian environment, but vassals at the time was literally, there were vassals in Spain, there were vassals throughout Europe, they were just serfs, they were people who worked for the monarchy for wages.
In fact, Christopher Columbus wrote, quote, "I believe that they started to receive something in payment, they would work, being exceedingly eager, and so set themselves to do anything that it should profit them."
And it shows that Columbus's intention is to pay these people. Columbus intended to pay them and to give them a proper indemnity for their service. And so they were at the behest, of course, of the monarchs, like anyone else. This is a feudal environment. You have to keep in mind the historical context. This is a feudal environment. And so, of course, these Indians would be working for the monarchs. They would be subjugated. There's a very famous quote in which he says he wants to subjugate the Indians. And by subjugate, he means he wants to make them subjects of the king, just as the people in Spain were subjects of the king. You see here now why one of the areas that has often been predicated to Christopher Columbus that he was a slave trader, or that he was interested in propagating the Atlantic, transatlantic trade of slave or something like that, is completely over-exaggerated, completely overblown. Christopher Columbus was following the papal policy at the time. The only people he enslaved were cannibals. And in fact, and he made a very clear distinction between those who were the natives, the Indians, who were not to be enslaved, and those who could be. Unfortunately, because Christopher Columbus was such a benevolent guy. The people and his crew did not really like him too much. They thought he was too strict. Christopher Columbus forbade his men from taking native women as concubines. He forbade his men to take men as slaves. And for this reason, there began to brew a mutiny. And eventually, it would be an all-out mutiny. It was really bad. It was just really bad. A lot of people don't know this, but Christopher Columbus was marooned once. He was sent back to Spain in chains. He saw himself oftentimes as like Job. He saw himself as Job, someone who was persecuted, and to this day, he's still persecuted unfairly and unjustly by those who, again, they usually hate Christ. Usually those who hate Jesus Christ tend to also hate Christopher Columbus. I don't think that's a coincidence. And there was another guy, and his name was Francisco Roldan. And Francisco Roldan, he was a commoner who had traveled with Christopher Columbus. Christopher Columbus had set him up as one of the captains while he was away. And while he was away, Francisco Roldan decided to take matters into his own hands when he didn't think Christopher Columbus was going to come back. And so he told the native people that they should work with him. And then he ended up betraying the native people. He was the one who began to rape the Indians. He began to plunder the Indians. And Christopher Columbus had no idea what was going on. So a lot of the abuses that people point out are not done by Christopher Columbus or even sanctioned by Christopher Columbus. These are things that happened in Christopher Columbus' stead. They happened when he left by people he had established to rule while he was away. And these are the people who committed abuses, one of which was Francisco Roldan. In fact, things got so bad with the mutiny that eventually Christopher Columbus had to begin hanging his own men. And he believed it was necessary to hang his own men as a way to show that the law applied just as equally to the Spaniards as it did to the Indians. He believed in fair treatment under the law. He believed in equality under the law for both the Indians and the Spaniards. And so when this mutiny began to arise, led by and first by Francisco Roldan, and later by others, he took these matters very seriously and he hanged those people who were rebelling against him. And at that site, another gentleman was going to later on arrest Christopher Columbus. His name was Francisco de Bobadilla. He was a knight. Francisco Bobadilla, he was a knight, and his job was to basically investigate the alleged abuses that Columbus was committing. His men made up a bunch of things. Like I said, they didn't like him very much, so they made up a bunch of things to the king. And so to investigate this was a guy named Francisco. And again, the reason why these men were making up things is because Christopher Columbus was restraining them. Christopher Columbus was the one that says, no, you can't rape the natives, you can't have concubines, you can't do that. And so this guy, he sees these Spaniards being hung, and he thinks that he doesn't understand the context, and he's filled with rage. He thinks that this is Christopher Columbus's form of mutiny or something like this. He doesn't think that it's fair to hang a Spaniard for what he did. And Christopher Columbus, he's thrown into chains, he's brought back to Spain, and he awaits trial. And many times his friends said, we can free you, we can get you out of this. And Christopher Columbus said, no, I want the royals in Spain to handle this. Now, Francisco de Bobadilla, he later learns that, Christopher Columbus was actually a really important person. And so he realizes he needs to have a lot of good evidence in order to justify putting him in chains. And so he begins an investigation, not into the abuses that were happening, by the way, under Bobadilla. There are many abuses, lots of, again, rapes, pillaging, these things that are well documented that I do not dispute, but these were not happening under Christopher Columbus. These were happening in spite of Christopher Columbus, but they're happening because Christopher Columbus wasn't there. And that was not investigated, by the way, but was investigated by Bobadilla, was Christopher Columbus. And so basically it was able to manufacture a lot of false testimony. For example, one of the accusations was that Christopher Columbus didn't want to baptize. I think you probably hear this one a lot. He didn't want to baptize the natives because he wanted to enslave them instead. And that is not at all true. According to his diary, Christopher Columbus was not interested in enslaving the natives. He rather did want to baptize them, but first he wanted them to have good instruction. He wanted them to have good catechism before they were baptized. He wanted them to be well catechized so they just weren't converting to Christianity and then going to live on their pagan lifestyle. He wanted them to know what was going on. They wanted them to be well catechized, and so he advocated bringing in priests and friars to the New World in order to convert them. This is always at the forefront of his mind. Christopher Columbus would go on to do many other things. He would also get marooned, like I mentioned earlier. And before he died, Christopher Columbus's last words were the same last words of Christ. Father, into thy hands I commend my spirit. Christopher Columbus lived and died a Christian. Christopher Columbus lived each moment of his life with the belief that Jesus Christ was king, that all people should be subject to Jesus Christ, and that the motivation in which we should live and work and the money that we should make should all go to restoring the kingdom of Christ, restore all things to Jesus Christ. This was at the forefront of Christopher Columbus's mind, and that to me is heroic virtue. And so in this channel, Christopher Columbus is a hero. End of the story.